Welcome to the Central Bank of Barbados. I'm Noveline Brewster, Public Affairs Officer, and it is indeed my pleasure to invite you to welcome you to the launch of the 2012 Financial Stability Report. The bank and the FSC are indeed delighted to share with you the findings of this report, a health check of the local financial system. This is the second such report which the bank and the FSC are presenting as part of their mandate to provide information on the resilience of the financial system and to report on any corrective measures. With those few words, it is my distinct honor to invite Governor Dr. DeLisle Worrell to deliver brief remarks. Governor?
Thanks very much, Noveline. Good morning, everyone. As a result of the series of financial crises that have beset countries across the globe in recent decades, there has been an increasing focus on the health of financial systems. Led by the UK and other industrial countries, central banks across the globe have initiated financial stability reports, which offer an assessment of the strengths and vulnerabilities of the financial system and the policies that serve to make the system more resilient. The Central Bank of Barbados and the Barbados Financial Services Commission today launch our second financial stability report for the year 2012. It covers the entire financial system, including banks, finance companies, credit unions, insurance companies, and the stock market. The analysis is done using indicators of financial soundness, stress tests, forecasts of financial variables, and scenarios based on alternative possibilities for the economy. The Financial Stability Report does not cover financial institutions that do international business because they are regulated to insulate domestic financial activity from their influence. The FSR is published annually, and an update will be published at mid-year. Thank you.
And thank you very much, Governor, for those very brief remarks. And as I alluded to in my opening remarks, this is a joint effort between the Central Bank of Barbados and the Financial Services Commission. So I now invite the acting head of the FSC, Mr. Warrick Ward, to also deliver brief remarks. Mr. Ward?
Good morning. Thanks, Noveline. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, Governor and distinguished guests. My remarks today are going to be quite brief, largely because I think what we are going to discuss here is what is going to be discussed later is of so much importance that we need to give it sufficient time. But why do we need to have a financial stability report? Now, we have seen a great degree of increased sophistication in terms of the financial infrastructure that we have seen in Barbados. And even among traditional credit unions, we have seen their levels of sophistication increasing. And so in terms of the high level of interconnectedness that we are seeing within the financial system and around the world, I think that we need to understand properly how are these systems interconnected, how the banks are interconnected with the credit unions and vice versa. And it is also very much important for supervision as well as for the crafting of regulation and policy. Another crucial aspect which I think we will focus on within the report is the need to have stress tests. Stress tests are quite important because they give us an indication as to the level of capital or the ability of the firm to absorb shocks that we that we model or that we think will occur at some point in the future. Now, stress tests, they look at the resiliency of the financial system. And so it gives us some sort of proactive measure through which we are then able to come up with some sort of policy or some degree of intervention. And so I therefore encourage you to pay specific attention or particular attention to that section of the report. I once again would like to thank all of those who have been involved in crafting the report. And obviously, I think it's a way that we should go in future. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
And thank you very much, Mr. Ward. And now to the main item on this morning's agenda, the unveiling of the 2012 Financial Stability Report. And to do that for us is our Deputy Director of our Research and Economic Analysis Department right here in the Central Bank of Barbados, Mr. Anton Belgrave. Mr. Belgrave.
Thank you, Noveline. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, Governor, and honored guests. What I will now do is present a synopsis of the findings of the report. The areas of coverage were the commercial banks, non-bank financial institutions, credit unions, insurance companies, and the equity and debt markets. To summarize the report in one easy slide, we found that there was a lower demand for loans from banks, a decline in asset quality throughout the system and higher credit risks, but banks have been resilient over the period of the crisis, and capital adequacy levels were well in excess of statutory requirements. The profitability of the banking system also improved. The credit unions experienced a slowdown in traditional growth rates and higher non-performing loans. Capitalization, however, remained in excess of international regulatory requirements. The insurance companies in the sample were also well capitalized and stable. In terms of the equity markets, the Trinidadian and international equity indices recovered, while there was only a modest shift in the domestic yield curve, despite a significant increase in issuance. The domestic assets of the deposit-taking institutions in Barbados grew by 4.5% as of September 2012. Commercial banks' assets recorded an underlying growth of 4.8% during the year, as banks increased their investments in treasury bills in the face of weak loan demand. In addition, there was a shift in assets from trust and mortgage finance companies to commercial banks due to the amalgamation of a trust company and its parent bank. Non-banks and credit unions, each of which account for about 10% of domestic assets, grew by 4.7% and 3.2%, respectively. Over on the liability side, domestic deposits grew by 1%, even though the accumulated funds at trusts and mortgage institutions, as well as credit unions, rose by 14.3% and 2.7%, respectively. Following broad-based declines in 2011, commercial banks' domestic assets expanded by 4.8% in 2012. Net of the consolidation of a bank and its associated trust and mortgage finance company. This growth was mainly reflected in a 20% increase in investments, primarily government treasury bills. The distribution of commercial banks' assets was similar to 2011, with loans and advances accounting for 48% of total assets, followed by foreign assets and investments. The loan portfolio of banks remained relatively flat since 2008, apart from the 5.5% increase which resulted from the merged operations in 2012. This consolidation only impacted the personal category, but a notable expansion in credit occurred in the tourism sector, while professional and other services fell by 6%. All other sectors remained effectively on par. As a result of these trends, liquidity in the banking system continues to be high, reflected by an increase in the liquid assets ratio from 12% at the end of 2011 to 13.2% as at September 2012. The spread between average lending and average deposit rates has been declining since 2009, falling from 7% in that year to 5.6% in 2012. This outturn was driven mainly by reductions in the average lending rate, a reflection of the weak loan demand since 2008. The capital adequacy graph on your screen shows that over the past 8 years, commercial banks have consistently surpassed the regulatory requirement of 8% for the capital adequacy. With risk-weighted assets declining by 8% over the period, the banking system's total capital adequacy as at September 2012 was 19.6%, compared to 19.3% recorded 1 year earlier. The lowest capital adequacy reported by any bank was 17.7%, with the highest being 21.6%. After exceeding 10% during 2010 and 2011 as a result of a few hotel loans categorized as substandard, the non-performing loan ratio for the banking system rose from 11.1% at the end of 2011 to 12.7% as at September 2012. This outturn is attributed to the continued worsening of credit quality in the hotel sector and is mainly reflected in the substandard category. Additionally, the doubtful and loss categories edged up slightly from 1.8 and 0.4% to 1.9 and 0.6%, respectively. Even with the increase in non-performing loans, losses have been very small when compared to the commercial bank's total loan portfolio. Though write-offs net of recoveries increased sharply during 2009, these still only represented 1.8% of the bank's total loans and advances. During 2012, 0.2% of total loans was written off. The net external position of the commercial banking system fell into deficit during 2012, reversing the surplus position recorded in 2011. This outturn reflected a substantial reduction in the net balances at headquarters and branches and net balances at other banks abroad. Turning our attention now to the non-bank financial institutions, the total assets of non-bank financial institutions experienced steady growth over the last 4 years, expanding at an average rate of 3% per annum. The underlying rise in 2012 was reflected in a buildup in balances with banks by two institutions and the growth in consumer credit. In terms of the credit unions, these institutions experienced modest growth in assets of about 3.2% during 2012. This was reflected in a significant increase in investment and is in contrast with the double-digit growth of the pre-crisis years. The growth rate of total credit for the credit unions declined further in 2012, falling below 5% and reflecting the weak loan demand of the wider economy. Loans continue to represent about 79% of total assets. Despite a reduction in the return on assets, the sector has remained profitable over the years, allowing it to enhance its capital and reserve position. The credit union capitalization ratio remained above the PEARL's guideline of 10%, reaching 12.4% at the end of the third quarter of 2012. This capitalization ratio has trended upward slightly since 2010 due to modest growth in equity and reserves. The four largest credit unions, which represent 83% of the sector's assets, were adequately capitalized, with capital and reserves to total assets being at least 10%. However, the quality of the loan portfolio of the credit unions has deteriorated gradually, as the classified debt ratio increased to 8.5% at September 2012. This was up from 6.9% at December 2011. The ratio of loan losses to gross classified loans fell in 2012 from 41 to 36% due to the expansion in loans in arrears. While this ratio is comparable to that of commercial banks, credit unions carry a greater proportion of loans in the most critical category. We next provide a brief summary of the findings of the insurance sector. The major challenges faced by the insurance industry remain sluggish growth, generally high debt levels among Caribbean governments, and low or declining interest rates. This environment has reduced the demand for insurance products while increasing the risk faced by insurers. General insurers retain more of the insurance risk of their various business lines, with the reinsurance premiums to gross premium ratio falling from 56.7 to 53% in 2011. And I should add that this data covers up to 2011. In addition, there was a slight decline in the life insurance risk undertaken by the regional life insurance industry, which retained 93.5% of the value of premiums on their balance sheet, compared to 95.2% in 2010. Short-term liquidity in the life insurance industry remained adequate, with the ratio of cash and deposits to current payables being significantly in excess of 150%. For general insurers, short-term liquidity in the industry remained more than adequate, with the ratio of cash and deposits to current payables being over 400% at the end of 2011. We next turn our attention to a series of stress tests that were undertaken by the Financial Stability Unit. The stress tests examined whether institutions' capital is sufficient to absorb potential losses associated with exogenous shocks. Under each scenario, the entire impact of the shock is transmitted directly to the institution's capital. For the lower bound or worst case scenario, seen as the red dash on your screen, 1% provisions were made on past loans, 5% on special mention loans, and 100% provisions were made on all other classifications of loans. While the system as a whole maintained capital adequacy ratios above the 8% statutory benchmark, two banks and three partnership companies would require a capital injection when adopting these extreme assumptions. The next stress test on your screen illustrates two conditions. One, the impact of a 100% increase in non-performing loans, and two, a series of incremental increases in provisioning requirements under new classified debt. The results indicate that with the most extreme case of 100% provisioning, banks and non-banks remained above the 8% threshold. While commercial banks and non-bank financial institutions were able to withstand these shocks, the credit union sector falls below the requirement when provisioning of 75% is applied. This stress test projects the path of non-performing loans based on current GDP estimates in the central bank's macroeconomic forecasting model. Under this framework, non-performing loans are expected to peak in 2013 before improving over the medium term. This stress test looks at the impact of rising deposit interest rates on the commercial bank. As the chart on your screen shows, the banks are able to withstand to absorb losses that might be associated with a very significant increase in interest rates. The final stress test assumed that the foreign investments of our commercial banks are lost in their entirety. This in turn would have triggered a deposit run on the domestic bank branches and subsidiaries. Table 3 presents the results based on cross-border exposures and shows the resulting range of capital adequacy for each region of exposure. Overall, the results suggest significant exposure to Caribbean and global affiliates, with one bank failing in each case. Losses to all other geographic regions were insufficient to erode capital levels below the 8% threshold. We now turn our attention to regional stock markets. The performance of the regional markets diverged significantly in 2012, with shares on the Trinidad and Tobago market rising by over 15%, while the Barbadian and Jamaican stock markets declined by 5.6% and 3.4% respectively. The decline in Barbadian listed stocks occurred despite modest improvements in the profits of several of the larger corporations on the stock exchange and represents the fourth year of investor losses since 2008. In contrast, international stock markets increased, with the MSCI World Index growing by 2.6% during 2012. This chart on your screen gives an indication of stock market turnover. And as you can see, activity on the Barbados Stock Exchange remained quite low as reflected by this measure. Turnover, as it has in the past, remained driven by takeover-related activity. During 2012, two issues of Treasury notes and 8 issues of debentures were offered to the public at weighted average coupon rates of 6.2% and 7.3% respectively. Approximately 3/4 of the new issues during the year were taken up by the National Insurance Scheme and insurance companies. While there was little movement at the long end of the yield curve, the short end of the curve shifted upwards slightly compared to 2011. So in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, the fallout of the weak global and domestic macroeconomic environment was a worsening of credit quality in the Barbadian banking system. In spite of this, the financial system remained robust by all prudential measures evaluated in this report. Thank you very much for your attention.
And thank you very much, Mr. Belgrave, for that very comprehensive report on the findings of our 2012 Financial Stability Report, which, as you would have heard throughout this presentation, is a joint project by the Central Bank of Barbados and the Financial Services Commission. It's time now to field our questions. We invite you to please raise your hand and to identify yourself when you are posing your questions. And as I said earlier, someone will give you a mic. If I may introduce the panelists briefly, though, we have Michelle Doyle-Lowe joining us for the first time. Michelle is the Director of the Research and Economic Analysis Department in the bank, and you heard earlier from our governor and, of course, from the head of the FSC, Warrick Ward. Welcome again to this panel discussion. I now invite any questions from the members of the audience. Okay, if there are no questions as yet, I will get the ball rolling. Governor or Michelle, what is the key message you would want people following this presentation online and our audience to leave here with today?
Well, I think Anton covered it quite nicely in that the reality is that we know we've seen the effects of the economic slowdown and the financial crisis. At the end of the day, when we look at those effects in terms of the NPLs, which have worsened a bit, the reality is that we still have sufficient capital to cover the event of any unexpected shock. And that is the one comfort that I think should be conveyed to everyone in reading the report, and that it extends not only to the banking sector, but to the non-bank community.
And perhaps that's a good point on which we can invite a comment on that same note from Mr. Ward.
Yeah, thanks, Novelin. What we have been doing, and we have seen, as we have been hearing for the whole morning, we have seen some degree of increase in terms of the non-performing loans, or we should say the deterioration of the loan portfolios. However, on a main, in aggregate, most of our non-performing entities, they all have sufficient capital to meet the requirements of the current environment. However, this is something that we still want to remain vigilant on. We still need to make sure that we have done our homework to make sure that if we are not surprised by any entity who has befallen quote-unquote hard times. And so this is an area which the FSC, we are constantly looking to update, and we are constantly looking to look at our measures in-house to make sure that the industries understand primarily that we are here to protect the policyholders, we are here to protect the constituents.
Before you ask your question, Kent, I'll take a comment from the governor.
Yeah, I just wanted to add to what was said that, the important thing to realize in our financial system is that the difficulties that we are seeing are not as a result of any deficiencies of the system itself, and the efficiency of the system or not. It is as a result of the economic circumstances. And that is precisely what you expect and why financial institutions hold capital. So that if economic circumstances over which they have no direct control impact on them and impact on their customers in a way that forces some adjustment in their portfolios, the capital is their insurance that they can do that in a measured way. The other point I want to make is that the increase in the non-performing loans has not resulted in any significant actual losses at financial institutions. The actual losses that the financial institutions have recorded, net of any recoveries that they've been able to make on obligations which are not serviceable, have to be written off, those actual losses remain very small, less than 1% of the portfolios. And as a result, and the majority of the loans that are in difficulty, the financial institutions are able to work with the clients to achieve a workout which will restore those loans to health in the process of time.
Thank you very much, Governor. Kent?
Morning to the panel. Kent Jerson, Caribbean Broadcasting Corporation. I note that the banking system remains robust in general, or the financial system, I should say. But given the stress test, was there any bank or financial institution that raised cause for concern?
I not really. The way we do stress tests is that we look at all possible circumstances. And we graduate the stress test. So we are looking to see at what point does capital fall below the 8% ratio. Falling below the 8% ratio does not mean failure. It means that you have to put in more capital to get back to where you need to be. But we are saying that even that under the most extreme test that we have, we imposed, only one or two banks fell below that ratio. And they would, if that circumstances had does come to pass, they would be in a position to repair that by putting additional capital up.
Thank you very much. Mr. Cobham?
First of all, let me compliment the Central Bank and the FSC for some good quality work in terms of this presentation. And also for the vision of looking at the financial system holistically with all of the players in it. And even though I am the president of the Bankers Association, I do want to raise a question relative to the credit unions, because I believe that the credit unions in particular play a key role in the development of the society. And it is clear that the
the issue of the long and difficult economic circumstances. They are playing, havoc on the quality of the portfolios, not only of commercial banks, but also of the credit unions. The difference, however, between the two, certainly as it relates to Barbados, is that there are somewhat head offices and so on to call upon for additional capital, not so with credit unions. And I wonder if there is a level of non-performing loans that would create concern for the regulators. And secondly, what are the implications for this, for the stability of the broader financial system, should the credit unions have a greater challenge?
Right. Thanks for that question, Horace. What we have been doing, and many of the credit unions, we are represented here by the league. We have been working a lot with the league, as well as with the credit union industry, in making sure that we have increased our surveillance. We have issued new guidelines to the credit unions. But so far, we have not yet seen any level of delinquency to suggest that the credit unions are on the brink of failure. However, we should also note that the credit unions have a fairly skewed nature. We only have to really monitor to an in-depth level, or to look at the level of systemic impact on probably one or two credit unions. And so if that is the case, it means that our level of oversight in terms of the knock-on impact of the credit unions can largely be honed in onto these one or two credit unions. And at this point in time, we have no significant worries that this is going to significantly occur. But this is something that we need to obviously monitor as we go forward. And that's something that the FSC is really looking at throughout all the sectors that we monitor. We have recently sent out a raft of guidelines to all the sectors, and we are also looking to have more dialogue with the industry such that we are brought up to speed if there's anything that is on the ground that we have not yet heard about, that we are quickly brought up to speed about what's happening.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ward. Governor, you wanted to make a comment?
Yeah, just to add that one of the things that we're very happy about is, you know, speed with which the FSC has been able to, you know, sort of get up to really full operating capacity. We are working very closely with them, including in this particular exercise. Say that in the presentation itself, Anton would have given you information on the capital adequacy of those largest financial credit unions, which, as he said, pointed out, account for over 80% of the sector. So from the point of view of the financial system as a whole, we can be fairly confident that there is no systemic risk arising from the credit union sector.
Thanks, Governor. I recognize Mr. Pilgrim, who represents the credit union this morning.
Speaking on behalf of the credit union sector, I just wanted to make one or two observations. In relation to the whole question of capital adequacy, it is noted that in the domestic environment, that ratio is hard-coded in the legislation at the level of 10% of assets. In other jurisdictions, notably, for example, in the US, that ratio is actually at the level of 8% of assets. So if we factor that in as well, the point is that at the domestic level, if our current ratio is 12%, it certainly is quite adequate. The question I want to ask, though, before you say that, I should also say that the sector has been helping itself as well as it relates to institutional strengthening. Over the last 5 or so years, we have engaged in an institutional strengthening project co-funded by the Inter-American Development Bank. So we've certainly looked at improving the governance practice as well as the risk management practice of credit unions. And that continues to be an ongoing process championed and led by the Credit Union League. But as it relates to a question, though, the analysis of non-performing credit exposures, I'm not sure how much detailed work has been done by the FSC, because I believe that that type of analysis could benefit the sector going forward. Of course, I'm not sure if you are collecting all of the information that you need to collect from the sector to perform that analysis. So those are two related questions I would want to get some feedback on. Thank you.
Sure. Thanks for the question, Anthony. From our discussions, you would know that we have recently requested, we are looking at more information coming from the sector. And the reason that we are looking for more information is that we want to do a more in-depth analysis of the credit unions and the credit union sector. Not only the credit union, but we're also issuing new forms. We have issued new forms to the insurance sector. But that is these are the types of analyses that we are going to be doing with the credit union sector. And as you know, we have started regular dialogue with the league on a regular basis. And this is something that we're looking at, sharing with the league, sharing with the industry, these various points of analyses. And we also issued this guideline, the new guideline 8, which we will resubmit to the sector, which specifically looks at loan loss provisions, which would help us in crafting a standard for delinquencies that we would like going forward. Yeah. I hope that answered your question, Tony.
Yeah, thank you. I recognize Kent again.
Over the years, we've seen the insurance industry move to be more sophisticated in terms of the products that they offer. My question is the FSC confident that it is in a position right now to adequately deal with the industry in terms of both the legislative framework and personnel?
All right. Well, once again, that is something that we are also working on. Currently, we have done an in-house review of all of our legislation, which we will submit to the ministry for adjustment. So we have gone through all of our various legislations. We have, again, I alluded to it before, we have sent out new guidelines to the industry. We have also sent out new reporting forms that allows us to get the information on a more speedy basis and the types of information that will be required to specifically look at solvency for the insurance industry and also to look at other parameters which would guide us in order to become more proactive. So I think that we have a pretty good team though at the FSC, people who understands the various types of insurance products that can be brought. And so going forward, I think that we're in pretty good shape to deal with the insurance industry.
Yes, Mr. Pilgrim.
A related question, looking at public policy infrastructure for financial institutions. We currently have a situation where Warrick mentioned guidelines which have been issued, with the exception of guideline number 8, which I think is being reviewed. We do have the curious situation where there are no regulations at present. So I just wanted to get a comment in terms of time frame for the rollout of the regulations. That's an issue which obviously in the sector we have a keen interest in.
Oh, you might not have a question. Okay. you said it's an issue of policy. Again, the purview of policy is the minister. We can always look and inform, get feedback and inform when that policy changes to be made. At present, we haven't had any indication as to when the regulations are going to be set. Obviously, that is something which we would need to look at and we would need to discuss. And when, as you know, we have this collaborative arrangement with all of our stakeholders, and so whenever we're about to, it's again, it's hard-coded within the FSC Act to have consultation. And so when that occurs, we will obviously have consultation with the industry.
Thank you, Warrick. There is a lot happening at the FSC. Share with us your plans for making sure that this is disseminated to the public.
All right. As I mentioned before, one of the key things which we need to it's a step or tiered basis. We obviously need to speak to the sector first. We need to make sure that the sector is perfectly involved with whatever it is that we are planning. But we also recently took on board a communications unit. And so what you're going to be seeing more often is information coming out from the FSC on a more regular basis. There will also be the incorporation of a website. A website will be commissioned where we can have regular updates and information shared with the public, as well as our stakeholders and our companies, our registrants. Later this year and into next year, what we're also looking to incorporate is ease in filing. We recognize that filing is not the easiest thing within our current setting, our domestic setting. And we want to put in place, there's a project on board to set up a web-based filing system where companies can quickly and easily update their statutory returns on a more frequent basis, on a more timely basis. Again, the more timely we get the information, the more we are able to act on it. And so, you know, once that is done, we would obviously be in good shape.
Thank you. Yes, I recognize Mr. Cobham.
Governor, this is perhaps more for you, but given what you've seen, what has been presented, what is your best advice to the financial industry in terms of the next little while? Next year, 2 years, 3 years, what is your best advice to the industry in terms of being able to protect the stability that at least you see exhibited in these results?
I say very much keep on doing what you've been doing. You know, I think that we have a good foundation in traditional banking business. Loans and advances, you know, is the core of what banks and other credit institutions do for households and for businesses. And, you know, basically I think it is really we do best when we stick fairly close to that traditional kind of activity and perfect the mechanisms and the services through which you do that. I think if you do that, then it really gives you the soundest basis for the long term, which is really what we want to be to focus on. There are some lacunae in our financial system. We know that, principally, I think relating to the financing of small business, and that is always going to be a problem because. You know, if it is a small business, if it is not an established entity, then there's a question of it. What is the track record? What is the assurance that the lending institution can have that it will possess the ability to repay over the period of the advance? And, you know, I think that we always are going to have special schemes and special arrangements for small businesses. I think that is always going to have to be a feature of our financial system. But as far as the private financial institutions are concerned, I think that you know, existing practices, if they're well done, are quite fine.
Thank you very much, Governor. Perhaps at this point, something else that we could stress, either Michelle or the governor, is the fact that despite the hard times, deposit-taking institutions have been seeing Barbados save a little more, and the significance of that.
Yeah, I think when you examine both the level of saving in the system, as well as the net position with regard to credit levels, we realize that we are more conservative than we've given ourselves credit for. That people rely on the comfort of knowing that they have solid savings provided for them, and that how that compares to the level of leverage and borrowing that they're undertaking does not put them in a negative position. And that's important for us, not only in terms of the comfort with regard to personal credit and whether persons are overextending themselves, but for the entire system overall. And as most regulators draw comfort from those types of statistics and the soundness of a system that relies heavily on having an adequate buffer. May I just interject as well? I just wanted to emphasize as a spin-off of some of the things that Warrick mentioned in terms of data. To produce these types of technical reports, it really depends on the quality of the reports and the submissions that are received from the respective entities that are covered. And one thing that we have noted in trying to enhance the analysis is that more and more we have to pay attention to the finer detail in the reporting. And similar to the FSC, the bank is rolling out a suite of new schedules, which I know for some of the entities is a bit more cumbersome because they are more granular in detail. But that is the input that we need in order to do the type of analytics that we would want to perform. At the same time, it also allows us to meet our reporting requirement to international entities, which has intensified because of the issues that we would have seen in the last 5 years and the level of due diligence and in-depth coverage of risk assessment that we have had to undertake.
Thanks, Michelle.
Sure.
And perhaps you can explain to us, Michelle, or the governor, what's happening at the regional level to mitigate, a lot of our banks now are banks are owned by the Trinidadians. What's happening at the regional level to mitigate against any problems in Trinidad and Tobago and to avoid contagion within the banks in Barbados?
Mm-hmm.
No, that is an important initiative because, as you know, the difficulties that we've had have been largely as a result of financial events outside of Barbados. So there is in place a regional program to collaborate between the central banks of the region and the Center for Money and Finance in Trinidad and Tobago to produce an overarching report on the financial health of the region as a whole. A preliminary report has been done, which is more or less a progress report, reporting on the existing efforts in financial system analysis, and it is intended to, through that report, to identify what are the additional data requirements in order to give a comprehensive view of the Caribbean financial system as a whole. So that work is ongoing and is being coordinated through the regional grouping of central banks, which is going to meet in May this year to review progress as far as that is concerned.
Okay, that would be the CARICOM Central Bank Governors.
Absolutely.
Okay. Warrick, earlier you made mention of legislative reform. Can you share with us any particular areas in insurance, in credit union business that you are focusing on as you review the legislation?
In terms of the legislation, what we have looked at is a holistic review of all of the legislation, primarily not only for our domestic requirements, but also to meet international best practices and international standards that are required. For example, IOSCO. IOSCO, the International Organization of Security Organization Supervisors, they have had specific requirements on us. In order to say sign on one of their memorandum of understanding, we have needed to make specific changes to our legislation. Again, we're also moving more towards a risk-based type approach to regulation. And if you're moving to risk-based, it means that you require additional things or require specific things which need to be properly addressed by legislation or by regulation. We also have instances with which we think it is best to put it in a guideline, because as circumstances change, we might also need to be more flexible. And so we have looked at some of the guidelines, and that's why, for example, in the industry, we have had in guidelines through all the sectors that we currently monitor or we are responsible for. And so I can't pinpoint any specific area, but just that all the sectors that we look at, we have also shared with them the areas that we want to have changed and the reasons why we think that they need to be changed.
Yes, just to make a general comment about legislation, what we are finding, when I say we, I actually the international financial community as a whole, that because of the way the financial systems worldwide are changing, that there is a constant need to renew and update legislation. So, you know, we used to think that, okay, you get the legislation, you know, you get it right and you put it in place, and then it will, you know, you don't have to go back to amend for a very long time. But that is no longer the case. In fact, in Canada and some other countries, they now, I'm not sure if it's for all legislation or whether it's for financial legislation, but certainly for financial legislation, they write the legislation in such a way that it has to be revisited every 5 years, that it lapses after 5 years, and there has to be a debate to say, okay, we're going to sort of continue it for another 5 years or make whatever changes. And we are not yet at that stage, but we do have to contemplate this ongoing process of legislative amendment and update.
Mr.
Cobham. Governor, on the issue of regulation, is there any, besides the additional reporting that have been talked about, is there any new legislation or regulatory guidelines that are on the horizon that, that will impact the financial system? And secondly, any that speak more directly to the issue of the whole initiative around financial stability?
Right. We do have a number of amendments to the Financial Institutions Act, which is the act that you operate under, which are in process and which have been, as you know, discussed with you. So those will be, we are, in fact, in discussions with the Ministry of Finance and the Chief Parliamentary Counsel's office to ensure that those come on stream as soon as possible. Please don't ask me for the details, but I think you are probably more familiar with them than I am, but those are being fast-tracked.
What about Basel?
Yeah, my understanding, and again, I have a pretty good understanding of this, I have to confess. We are at Basel II, and Basel, what the critical thing, as far from our perspective with Basel, is getting the supervisory framework in place and getting it, making it, and fortifying it. Because, as you know, Basel II has three pillars. It has the supervisory pillar thing. It has the risk-based supervision, which we are doing, right? And then it has the other operational and so on and so forth. All of those we are working on as well. But, you know, as I keep saying, our financial system is a relatively simple financial system. It focuses principally on traditional products, and the traditional risks are what we have to worry about. As far as that is concerned, the main things are the kinds of risk analysis that we're doing and that are reported in our financial stability report, and the quality of our supervision. And that's what we're focusing on.
Thank you, Governor. Perhaps another point we should reiterate, Michelle and our Governor, is the fact that you did refer to the adequate capital that most institutions have, if not all, but the provisioning in light of the non-performing loans. We need to stress that as well.
Yeah, I think anyone looking at the report can see sort of how institutions have sought to compensate for the increase in the NPLs by increasing their capital adequacy. At the same time, the other point of comfort is that when you look, as we noted earlier, at the actual write-offs related to these loans, it's minuscule. So what that says is that certainly entities are aware of the issues with regard to the loan portfolio. They're compensating for it in terms of coverage, and certainly most entities have sound debt recovery efforts to sort of deal with their clients in terms of the issues that we know have been plaguing some corporates and some entities in the tourism sector that relate to their cash flow and the turnover of their business. So it is something that we can see that entities are paying attention to generally.
Yeah, and on that, the critical thing, as Michelle says, is that the provisions are enough to cover any prospective losses many times over.
Mm-hmm.
Many times over.
And that is indeed comforting. We'll take a wrap. Final remarks from the panelists. We start with you, Warrick.
Okay, starting with me, one of the key things which the FSC wants to put out there is that the FSC is an entirely new organization. It is one that it should not be seen as an amalgamation of all the previous entities, but one who looks to administer the various acts that it is responsible for. You will see a lot more coming from the FSC in terms of how we look to regulate all the sectors. In a very short space of time, I think we have achieved quite a lot. And we have received many kudos from the industry in terms of the direction in which they think we're going, they think is the best move for Barbados. And I would say within the next year or so, you will see much more coming out of the FSC. Specifically as we look at the various sectors, and specifically as we look at the areas that pose the greatest level of systemic risk to the actual financial system. So all I would say is just to keep tuned.
Who will speak on behalf? Michelle.
Well, I think I just want to emphasize in terms of the rigorous analysis with respect to the stress tests that were performed, that the extreme to which we went should give comfort to the fact that we have a sound and well-managed system. And that is something in this day and age that we should all be proud of. So that when you even look at it in extreme circumstance, you can still say to yourself, we've taken account of the interconnectedness, the contagion, but we still know that we would not be in dire straits if one of these events were to happen.
Thank you very much, Ms. Doyle-Lowe. And of course, thank you to the other panelists, our Governor, Dr. DeLisle Worrell, as well as the head of the FSC, Mr. Warrick Ward. This is not the vote of thanks. Ms. Doyle-Lowe will do the vote of thanks. Thanks for your participation. And the document is online. It's on the Central Bank's website, www.centralbank.org.bb. Mrs. Doyle-Lowe.
Thank you, Noveline. Governor of the Central Bank, Dr. DeLisle Worrell, management and staff of the bank, Warrick Ward, acting CEO of the Financial Services Commission, specially invited guests, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen. It is my pleasure this morning to express sincere gratitude to all those persons who have contributed in a small or big way to the production of the bank's second financial stability report and the planning and execution of this launch. We at the bank, as you well know, are very mindful of our mandate to keep the public well informed of relevant economic and financial issues. In this regard, we appreciate the spirit of cooperation that we tend to obtain from our stakeholders, especially as we seek to further leverage these associations going forward with the production of the next financial stability report, which we have already embarked upon. I would therefore encourage representatives from across the financial sector to continue to play your part in contributing and supporting our efforts to monitor and assess developments through the timely submission of your financial data and the active participation in discussion forums such as this one. Indeed, the realities of the last 5 years, as we've touched on briefly this morning, have emphasized the need for critical financial risk assessment, especially given the increased degree of interconnectedness across our regional landscape. As I now begin to express thanks to all of those who would have been part of this process, I crave your indulgence for a moment by saying home drums beat first. And I am sure that you will forgive me, having witnessed firsthand the tremendous effort of our financial stability unit in the research department in the face of many challenges to produce the report that we are launching today. My heartfelt thanks to the members of the FSU for going above and beyond, working late into the night on occasion, to ensure that we have, as a final product, a high-quality report. So great work, folks. And I'm sure that you do feel a sense of pride and accomplishment in the final product, which is of value to any stakeholder within our community. I would also like to express thanks to Governor Worrell for his welcoming remarks, which epitomize his enthusiasm and support as the champion of financial stability, not only here at the bank, but regionally. And thank you to Warrick for those stimulating remarks and participating in the panel discussion. More generally so, special thanks to the FSC, which is a key partner in this initiative, for their invaluable input to fill the gaps, especially as it relates to activity in the non-bank financial sector. Many thanks to Anton for his riveting presentation on the key findings of the report. Anton's passion for his work on financial stability is evidenced today, not only by way of the presentation, but in terms of the quality of the FSR, given that he leads the team that deals with the report. To Noveline, the moderator of the question and answer session, thank you for keeping us on track. Indeed, organizing an event such as this is no simple task, even for our bank's team that is quite experienced at delivering on quality events. So I want to express gratitude to the organizing committee under Noveline's guidance, as well as to the technical team and the media for covering the event. Last but by no means least, I wish to thank the participants who took the time out to attend the launch, as well as our fellow staff members who are joining us online. So, ladies and gentlemen, once again, on behalf of the bank, I would like to thank you for attending this launch, and I certainly encourage you to visit our website and obtain a copy of the report for your perusal. as is usually the case, we like to engage with stakeholders. So if you have any comments or feedback, please feel free to direct those to us. I thank you.
And thank you very much, Michelle. That's where we take the wrap. And thanks again for those of you online who tuned in. We're out of here. Adios.